Thank you very much. So I'm very excited to give a Zoominar talk. So I will talk about the joint work with Louis Yos and David Kashdan. And let me first of all try to explain what is this lecture about. So I'm going to discuss quantum classical correspondence, namely the thesis that quantum mechanics contains classical in the limit h bar goes to zero, Planck constant goes to zero. And the kind of main feature of this correspondence is that this correspondence is not precise. So it's classical result, and actually if you think that roughly speaking quantum mechanics is modeled by matrix algebras of maybe very high size, yeah, size goes to infinity, and classical mechanics is after all functions on symplectic manifold with Poisson bracket. So obviously there is no precise morphism from one algebra to another, yeah, from functions to matrices. And this give rise basically to two problems. So first problem is to detect quantum footprints of a symplectic geometry or topology or Hamiltonian dynamics in the phase space, which is an exciting task. And I, for a couple of years, was giving a talk about this. And obviously, I mean, it's just very beginning, but it's not my topic for today. And the second topic is the following, that since the correspondence is not precise, so then we wish to focus on quantum errors. So maybe these errors are not less interesting than the kind of main dish itself, yeah, this correspondence. And the point which I'm going to make today is that these quantum errors are governed by Riemannian geometry. Somehow ideas of this kind appeared in the literature, so I think that notably Clauder developed this from certain viewpoint, so our viewpoint will be completely different. So what I want to emphasize that from symplectic viewpoint, quantization is actually not unique and not canonical at all. So moreover, there is a lot of different approaches to quantizations, a lot of different quantizations, and there is no, so to say, clear meaning when two quantizations are equivalent and so on. Okay, so this, of course, causes difficulties. And on the other hand, this gives rise to the following question. So maybe among some quantizations, among this wealth of quantizations which we have, maybe there is the best one. And one of the main points which I want to make, so it's one of the main points of our joint work with Louis and David, that indeed one can in some way define optimal quantizations, and these quantizations turn out to correspond to compatible almost complex structures on symplectic manifold, which is the object which starting from Gromov's work we like in symplectic geometry. So let me try to discuss this thesis in more details. So first of all, what I want to say that there are two quite different approaches to quantization. So one approach is deformation quantization or star product. So we view quantization as deformation of the usual product structure on functions. Okay, so if h bar is a formal parameter, like formal Planck constant, so we define operation f star g, which is fg plus h bar c1 of fg plus h bar square c2 of fg plus etc. And we assume that CKs are d-differential operators, so differential with respect to each variable vanishing on constants. And there is one restriction, the bracket correspondence, namely commutator in with of functions with respect to this operation is I times h bar times Poisson bracket plus terms of higher order in h bar. Okay, and so when I write C infinity of m, I kind of mix viewpoints. So I'm thinking simultaneously on real valued functions, but sometimes on complex valued functions. And so then the operation is kind of complex linear and so on. So this operation was introduced at least in 1977 by Jan Flatow, Fronsdon, Lechnerovich, and Schnurheimer. And since then, was very intensively studied. I will return to some history later on. And at this point, I wish to pass to another approach of quantization, which is based on correspondence between functions and operators. So first of all, let me recall that mathematical model of quantum mechanics, at least of finite volume quantum mechanics, consists of a finite dimensional Hilbert space C over space over complex numbers. I denote by L of H Hermitian operators on H, so these are observables, and S density operators, operators which are positive with raise one, these are states. And h bar is, as I said, the Planck constant. And so we have this so far naive table of quantum classical correspondence. So here you see classical objects and here quantum objects. Observable, which are functions on symplectic manifolds, correspond to Hermitian operators on phase space of quantum mechanics. States, which are probability measures on symplectic manifolds, correspond to density operators, so positive trace one operators, and Poisson bracket corresponds to commutator, yeah, with normalization I over h bar. And the only thing I wish to somehow make clear is the story about states. So somehow, if you ask a topologist what is a state for a Hamiltonian system, so kind of natural answer will be a point. So point, of course, corresponds to Dirac delta measure at this point. And on the other hand, among quantum states, there is a remarkable class of states, which are rank one projectors, which basically corresponds to up to a phase unit vectors in the Hilbert space. So what I want to say that in this quantization story, pure states appear, but somehow this Dirac delta measures basically do not appear as a result of dequantization. So they are too sharp for quantum mechanics. So if you take a quantum state and dequantize it, you necessarily get something blurred. So it will be a kind of actual probability measure and not a point. And this is one of the difficulties of the translation. Yeah, so we know that, for instance, in symplectic topology, we're extremely sensitive to points, yeah, so be it intersections of sets or be it fixed points of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms, not just, you know, almost fixed points and so on. Okay, but here we really have to talk about measures. So now let me make this table a little bit more precise. So assume that M is a closed symplectic manifold of dimension 2D. And HH bar is a family of Hilbert spaces of finite but growing dimension. So dimension will grow like H bar in the power minus D. Okay, and H bar is not a continuous parameter. I will actually assume that H bar equals to 1 over K, where K is a sequence of natural numbers going to infinity. So you will see, I mean, there is good reason for that. This will be convenient. So we have a linear correspondence, linear map from TH bar from functions to Hermitian operators on Hilbert space. So here I mean real functions, and this is a linear map over reals, but we can complexify it, and we will actually do it for free. And it has main features. So I decided to do the following thing. Instead of listing all the axioms, I will list the main axioms, and some will remain in the shadow, but otherwise it will be hard to distinguish really important things for this talk from less important. So first of all, a very crucial feature of quantization, which I'm going to consider, it's called Березин-Теплиц quantization. It's positivity. So my quantization sends, I mean, this map TH bar sends non-negative functions to positive semidefinite operators. Also, this quantization is normalized, so it sends one to the identity. But this positivity will actually change the game in a sense. Yeah, so it will be important. So then we have the following rule of quasi-multiplicativity. So what I want to say that roughly speaking, this quantization sends product to product. Okay? But actually, I want to say this a little bit better, saying that there exists a bidifferential operator C such that product TH bar of F TH bar of G equals to TH bar of FG plus H bar C of FG plus terms of higher order. So of course, existence of such an expansion is a serious restriction. So then there will be a property which is called reversibility. So you see, you can quantize. So we think about this map TH bar as quantization. And with proper normalization, the dual space, I'm a little bit kind of hiding the truth here, but it's okay. So the dual map is dequantization. And so then we ask the question, what happens when we first quantize function and so then dequantize function? And the answer is that in the first order in H bar, nothing happens. So we get the same function. So quantization and dequantization kind of does not change things. Error is of order H bar. So I must say, and I will say this in a second, that one can look at this with bigger resolution and get to a pretty interesting point. But so far, that's what is needed for this talk. And finally, bracket correspondence, which in a sense is the main feature of quantum classical correspondence, that commutator corresponds to Poisson bracket. So commutator TH bar F TH bar G equals to IH bar TH bar of Poisson bracket FG. So some remarks are in order. So first of all, we have a couple of extra axioms which are not discussed, like that uniform norm on functions corresponds to operator norm on operators, and the mean value of functions correspond to a normalized trace of operators. So remainders, so you see, so for instance, when you see in this formula capital O of H bar square, there is no chance to have uniform remainders. So these remainders actually do depend on F and G. And the assumption is that they depend on certain number of derivatives of F and G, which actually happens in all imaginable examples. And so by Березин-Теплиц quantization, I actually mean the quantization which satisfies all these axioms plus some the extra axioms which were not highlighted in the talk, but just briefly discussed. So a couple of remarks. So first of all, this positivity axiom means that Березин-Теплиц quantization, this Теплиц operator, th bar of f, is just integral of f against some positive operator valued measure. So incidentally, this is an important character in this talk and will be discussed later in more details. So now quasi-multiplicativity is a remnant of the following. So actually, there in all known examples, I would put it in all interesting examples, there exists actually a star product, a full star product, so that th bar of f times th bar of g equals to th bar f star g, but this should be considered as formal asymptotic expansion, right, because f star g is just formal multiplication, it's a formal series in h bar with functional coefficients. So as I said here, th bar is necessarily extended to complex functions, and it's kind of clear because that this should be, because on the nose product of two Hermitian operators is not a Hermitian operator, right? So it's kind of general endomorphism. So this guy has to have real and imaginary parts, so to say. And finally, this decomposition of quantization and dequantization, which I declared to be basically identity plus little error in my story, is called Березин transform. And this is very important operator, which actually is the whole world, and maybe in the very end I will say something about this. So do you have questions? So maybe it's really a good point to ask some questions.
So this is one, so you mentioned one concrete quantization. I mean, how unique is it?
No, so that's exactly the case. I didn't mention any quantization yet. So the existence of this guy is highly non-trivial theorem, not ours. Yeah, I will mention the history when I will pass to examples. And the question about uniqueness, so here you a little bit run ahead. So it's very, very profound question, because there is no one kind of candidate for this presidential race. Yeah, so I mean, several versions of definitions, and let's say that in deformation quantization, there is definition which is very good, which does not help much here. And in this Березин-Теплиц story, the question about equivalence of quantizations will be discussed in the end of this talk. So the answer to your question is the following. So existence is highly non-trivial, and uniqueness is a jungle. So that's how it works. So yes. So another question from Hiroli Tanaka: when you say family of Hilbert spaces, should I think of them as having map between them, forming a filtered co-filtered diagram of finite dimensional Hilbert space? So this is a great question. So the answer is no. Okay, but I mean, in this story, the questions, the spaces are not related in any way, instead, except the fact that the very fact of existence of this asymptotic expansion, so is some condition. But somehow we discussed several times with David and Louis this issue, so whether one can change the axioms of quantizations so that this Hilbert spaces at the end of the day become related. So this would immensely help to build a theory, but we don't see a good answer. So that's the issue. So more questions, please.
Is there a criteria, like a topological criteria, to make sure that this star product so that TH is multiplicative exists.
I will give some examples. So again, that's the question about existence. I will show you some example, and I will give some very, very toy case of classification of the variant. So it's existence of such a structure is seems to be a complicated thing, at least in the context which I described. Okay, so maybe I will continue. So yes, and I see that. Okay, so what will happen if I will do this? Right. So at least in this way you see the names of the title. So the previous one, if somebody has doubts, it was about Berezin-Teplitz quantization. So now I'm arriving to the main character of the story, and this is unsharpness cycle. So what is unsharpness cycle? So remember this quasi-multiplicativity axiom, th bar of f times th bar of g equals to th bar plus fg plus h bar c of fg plus capital O of h bar square, where C of FG is the differential operator. And the only thing which we know kind of from general properties, so we know that multiplication of matrices is associative. And so this C satisfies the Hochschild cycle condition, like F1 times C of F2 F3 minus C of F1 F2 F3 minus CF1 plus CF1 F2 F3 minus CF1 comma F2 times F3 equals to zero for each triple of functions F1, F2, F3. So this property of being a cycle at some point will be useful. So now we do the following thing. So we somehow split this cycle into antisymmetric and symmetric part. So C minus of FG will be C of FG minus C of GF over 2, and C plus of FG will be C of FG plus C of GF over 2. And this C minus guy is very beautiful. So because of the bracket correspondence, so we know that commutator of these two matrices corresponds to IH bar times quantization of the Poisson bracket. And so the C minus of FG is nothing else but I over 2 commutator FG. And C plus is some symmetric unsharpness cycle, which is the main, sorry. So it's some symmetric cycle, which is called unsharpness cycle. And this wording will be in great detail explained slightly later, okay? And this cycle is the main object of our study. So the first remark is the following, that this operator C plus is actually bidifferential operator of order 1, 1. And the question is how one can prove anything from the axioms which we gave. So the answer is the following, that this positivity is a very heavy restriction on the situation. And because of this positivity, I mean, we know that C plus is operator of order 1, 1. And from this, there is an immediate consequence that we can rewrite this cycle in a slightly kind of more sympathetic form. So there exists a bilinear symmetric form on TM. So that C plus of FG is minus 1/2 of G applied to Hamiltonian vector fields of functions f and g. And because kind of my viewpoint is that symplectic manifold is given and fixed, right? So thus all the information about this cocycle is contained in this bilinear symplectic form, and that's something which we wish to study in the present talk. But maybe at the moment I formulated the main objects of interest, basically I take this C of FG, which enters quasi-multiplicativity formula, and do some pretty elementary preparations, so I arrive to a bilinear symmetric form on TM. So now I want to study this form, but maybe I feel that exposition at this point is becoming kind of a little bit abstract, so let's consider examples. So first example is a great example. It's an example of Keller quantization of Keller manifolds, which is based on techniques of Boutet-Demanvelian gaming, but in the form we're using it, it's article by Boardman, Meinrenken, and Schlichenmeier of 94. So I think they were basically first who formulated quantizations, keeping track of what happens with norms. Yeah, so in these norms actually of great importance. Yeah, so this correspondence between uniform norms on functions and operator norms on matrices. Yeah, so for instance, critical for applications to symplectic geometry, or rather to links with symplectic geometry, and so on. So Keller quantization also is attractive because it's very easy to describe it. So assume that we have a closed Keller manifold, and at this point, we know how to quantize manifolds which satisfy the following quantization condition. So we assume that cohomology class of symplectic form divided by 2 pi is integral. So we take a holomorphic Hermitian line bundle over M and curvature, so that curvature of the corresponding Chern connection is I omega. And we look at the space of holomorphic sections of high tensor power of L, okay? And I probably have to emphasize that H bar in this example is 1 over K. And it should be stated in some way. So let's see whether I can do it. So H bar is 1 over K, and then we do the following, I would say, ridiculously elementary construction. So you see, we look at this space of holomorphic sections, which is an extremely rigid object. Yeah, so by far kind of more rigid than we need in symplectic geometry. And we put it into L2 space of all sections. And so then which is in contrast to this extremely soft. And so then what we're doing, so we're forcing our operator to act on sections in the following way. So we take a holomorphic section and simply multiply it by a function. So then we again get a section, but of course not holomorphic anymore. And so then what happens that we simply project this non-holomorphic section back to holomorphic sections orthogonally with respect to L2. And in this way, we really get correspondence to H bar. Yeah, so it sends functions to operators, and it turns out that this is quantization in the sense which I described today. So here one can actually calculate this unsharpened standard. So this, remember that we are studying this symplectic, this symmetric form, which somehow encrypts at unsharpened cycle C plus of FG. And this unsharpened standard is simply a Riemannian metric, I mean, which is part of the scalar structure. Yeah, so omega of CJ. So Keller Riemannian metric, we started with Keller manifold. So this is the result of calculation. So any questions about this example, because it's a kind of fundamental example here. Something to ask? Okay, so maybe you will have an opportunity to ask later. So there exists an almost Keller version of this story, so which started with the work of Guillemin, and then Bortwe, Kuriba, Schiffman, Zeldichma, Marinescu, Charles, Jost, Luma, Marinescu. So there were many articles which did the following thing. So again, you have you already have almost complex structure on a symplectic manifold. You still denote by GJ Riemannian metric. You still have this quantization condition, and you modify the construction. So you, instead of speaking about homomorphic sections, so you do the following thing. So you consider a certain version of Laplace operator on sections of the bundle L in tensor power k, and so then what happens that you have you see that there is a big gap in the spectrum. Yeah, so there is a group of eigenvalues kind of near zero, roughly speaking, and then the rest of eigenvalues far to the right. So you take, so to say, small eigenvalues, whatever this means, and consider the space spent by them. So that's the construction of almost Keller quantization. And in this case, again, unsharpness tensor equals to this Riemannian metric, compatible Riemannian metric, which appeared at the moment we started with almost complex structure. And so then analysis of these examples kind of shows that you see, I mean, these are two mainstream examples of Berezin-Toeplitz quantization. And in both cases, this unsharpness tensor is actually the compatible, is the compatible Riemannian metric. So it's a Riemannian metric associated to a compatible almost complex structure. And the question is whether it's always the case. And somehow the answer is no. That the next example, which is very simple, is the following. So let's think about Keller, almost Keller case. We do not care. Actually, you can think about your favorite Keller manifold. Yeah, and let TH bar be quantization, which is kind of standard quantization, and delta is a positive Laplace-Beltrami operator. So then, let's just smear original quantization by the heat flow. So T is a parameter, positive parameter, and we denote TH bar T of F to be TH bar of the flow of F under heat flow, yeah, for time TH bar. And it turns out that this is a quantization which satisfies all the above axioms, including positivity. But then what happens that this unsharpness tensor actually grows, that instead of being a compatible Riemannian metric, yeah, so it becomes a constant, strictly positive constant, times a compatible Riemannian metric. And I don't know, I never seen this example in the literature, so it seems to be kind of, unless I will be given a reference, it seems to be a new example of in this work. Any questions, please? So I mean, this is the main pool of examples which we'll consider. Yeah, and I will not talk about this almost complex quantization. So for me, the world consists of Keller quantization and diffusion, basically. Yes.
You have a question in the chat.
Yes. Is the unsharpness? Yes, I even have several. So how does almost Keller quantization vary when we vary J? So this is the question from John Pardon. And I will give the answer in the very last slide in some toy example. So generally speaking, I don't have an intelligent answer to this question. And is the unsharpness tensor always positive definite? So that's one of the main results of the paper. So let me, I think it's a good time now to formulate the main theory. Okay, so I will answer Tang's question in a second. So let's say Monaco be simply closed simply optic manifold, TH bar Berezin Toeplitz quantization, and theorem in three parts. So indeed, unsharpness tensor is always a Riemannian metric. But moreover, it's not just a Riemannian metric. It has the following structure. It is a compatible Riemannian metric plus non-negative symmetric bilinear form. So we can go up, so to say, but we cannot go down. So second statement, which is a elementary consequence of the first one, that volume of our manifold with respect to this unsharpness metric, right, is always greater or equal than symplectic volume, and the quality is if and only if this increment rho is zero, so G equals to GJ. So this is in a sense characterization of compatible metrics. I will emphasize this point in a second. And third is the following. Assume that M omega is quantizable, and take any metric of this form. So then it arises from some Berezin Toeplitz quantization. Okay. So that's more or less the picture which we have here, and I will maybe a little bit comment on it, on this picture. So first of all, decomposition of the form GJ plus rho is of course not unique. But on the other hand, if G is fixed, so then there exists unique G orthogonal omega compatible almost complex structure, as we know. Yeah, and so then rho also becomes kind of compatible with J, but it's not strictly positive, it's greater or equal zero. And in this part three, in the existence part, we don't assume anything. So we don't assume that rho is also kind of compatible with G. So we simply take this formula and construct, I will say in a second, how construct the corresponding quantization. So now proof of three, I will not say much, but it's the same idea. It's almost Keller quantization followed by diffusion. And what I want to say that if rho is not strictly positive, but greater or equal than zero, so then it's a little bit of headache to produce a diffusion. Yeah, so either you have to go into Markov operators or something like this, but fortunately there is an easy way. You simply design the Schwarz kernel of corresponding diffusion and simply by hands proof things. Daniel. Does unsharpness tensor determine the quantization? How, to what extent? So I like the question. So exactly as John's question, last slide more or less, okay, will be given. So these are open questions, and we thought about them. Okay, there is some toy situation where we know something, but our knowledge is very small, and actually this toy situation becomes maybe technically more difficult than when everything I'm trying to say here. Okay, so now proof of one. So proof of one, so just if you wish, this proof of positivity is simple. It's kind of linear algebra, but I think that what is funny, that it is absolutely related to kind of theory of quantum measurements. So if you're a little bit kind of familiar with these quantum measurements and you grasp the parallel, so then the proof is almost a couple of lines. And that's exactly what I want to explain, because I think this is a kind of okay, at least something which is of interest to me. Okay, so at this point I don't have much. Okay, so first of all, any more questions about formulation of the main theorem, if you have? Okay, so then I will plan the rest of the talk like this. So I will say a couple of words about this application of noise, and so then I will start answering question about uniqueness and the comparison and so on. Does not diffusion violate the axiom of locality? No, because you because you see, you do the following thing. So maybe I can answer this question relatively easily. So consider this e in the power th bar. That's question by Giovanni Felber. So consider e in the power th bar delta, and let's just develop it into series, right? So it's like one minus th bar delta plus etc. Okay, so I just develop this exponent into the series, and so then I see the following thing, that my original quantization is, my new quantization is the original quantization composed with the change of variables, which is actually pretty much legitimate in this star product. Okay, and so then I will get a quantization which satisfies all the axioms, including kind of locality and so on. However, the only problem which I could get is the lack of positivity. But fortunately, this heap kernel preserves positivity. So does it, Giovanni, does it answer my question? Sorry, does it answer your question? Okay, and I'm not sure. I'm not sure here.
Unmute himself.
I should unmute myself. Maybe Giovanni.
Sorry, do you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. So no, I want, because in your axiom you had some finite number of derivatives n, but now you say that you have n derivatives at the order h to the n or something like this, right?
Yes, so I'm saying that remainders depend on finite number of derivatives. I believe that here I think like four derivatives would be good or something like that.
I think it makes sense to remind axioms. to put them on the slide, so we'll see whether.
So this was the axiom, right? So I somehow tried to hide this under the carpet. I just said that remainders depend on finite number of derivatives of f and g. Okay, and
N depends on the order of h bar, right?
Or times h bar in certain power.
Right.
It depends. The number of derivatives depends on the order in h bar.
Yes, right.
Yes, so it will be formula like this, like 100 derivatives of this pair, whatever this means, times h bar in the, so whatever it should be, times h bar square.
Okay, thank you.
So this should hold also for this heap kernel, because we have control. Okay, so any more questions, please? So let me remind that I was here, right? So I was with the formulation of the main theorem. Okay. So now remind you some language. So what is positive operator valued measure? So if H is a complex Hilbert space, and L of H space of Hermitian operators and S of H space of states. So operator valued measure, its measure on a good topological space, it will be always closed manifold with Borel sigma algebra for us. And this is just a map from sets of this sigma algebra to Hermitian operators, which is normalized, so total measure is one, of on empty set it's zero, it's always non-negative, and it's countably additive. So it's kind of really a measure valued in positive operator. And so this object appears on two different occasions in quantum mechanics. So one of the occasions is theory of quantum measurements, where this is an absolutely mainstream object. And another is quantization, where it also appears in, for instance, in the book of Lanzmann about quantum and classical mechanics, right? So he systematically developed this approach to quantization via operator valued measures. And so, because we're working with finite dimensional spaces, so each such operator valued measure can be written in the following form. So it's dimension of the Hilbert space times state depending on the point of omega d alpha, where alpha is some Borel probability measure. So I just said that in finite dimensions I should not worry, so my PUVM has a density. And this f of s in the quantization story, so they correspond to coherent states. So I will explain this in a second. But what I want to say that there is a natural integration operator. So we send L1 functions on omega with respect to this measure alpha to Hermitian operators. And the very first example is the following, that the Bayesian-Toeplitz quantization, so let's say, is always given in general case, is given by sequence of L of h bar valued POVNs, okay? So it's just integral of f against certain POVN. And these POVNs have a remarkable form in the case of Keller quantization. So remember that we have a Keller manifold and we have a space of holomorphic sections on LK. So then we can do the following thing. So what is Kadaira embedding? So on each point S in the manifold, So for each point Z in the manifold, we consider the space of sections vanishing at this point. And this is a hyperplane. And so what we do, we consider orthogonal projectors to line orthogonal to this hyperplane. Right, so this gives me exactly Kadaira embedding from M to P to projectivization of the dual space. And so then the fact is the following, that there exists a function which is called Ronsley function. I will not discuss it much here. So that my Berezin Toeplitz quantization in the Keller case looks as integral of F times this function times Px, so this Kadaira projector, if you wish, d volume, d Liouville volume on the manifold. So in a sense, this Kadaira embedding theorem dictates the form of this positive operator valued measures, which measure which enters the quantization. Okay, and so then what is the quantum measurement? So quantum measurement is the following story. So assume that we have a POVM on omega. So we interpret POVM as measuring device. And in the state row, probability of finding the value of measurement in subset X of inside omega is mu rho of X is a certain measure, which is just trace W of X rho. And here is a kind of very basic example. So this is in a sense the main axiom of quantum mechanics, yeah, from Neumann quantum mechanics. So if we have observable, we consider spectral decomposition with different eigenvalues. And we consider the space of the spectral projectors as a projector valued measure on an abstract space from 1 to k, which number these projectors. I mean, it's not important that this one and k are numbers, they could be elephants. But it's important that on this set we have POVM, which takes values lambda j with probability trace p j rho. Okay, and so that's how we think about values of quantum mechanical observable. And so then one does the following thing. So assume that you have such a measuring device, a kind of abstract POVM. So then you can perform an unbiased approximate measurement. So you take any classical observable, so this is a classical choice on omega, and it defines your random variable on omega with respect to mu rho. And it is unbiased in the sense that expectation of WF rho equals to expectation of this integral F dW. So now if I'm doing a little bit kind of, as you know, Ministry of Truth, I wish to rewrite history, and I'm doing the following thing. So assume that this is observable of interest and I designed PVM in order to measure it, right? So then this measurement will be unbiased because expectations of my measurements will be the same. However, this is approximate measurement because probability distribution dramatically differ. And where is the drama? The drama is that variance grows. That variance of this measurement is variance of the original observable, which is kind of its statistical model is described by this example, plus non-negative increment. And this non-negative increment is called Azava noise operator, and it measures unsharpness of the measurement. Okay, and so here the following philosophy enters the play. Yeah, so we know that there is uncertainty principle in quantum mechanics, and so everything in quantum mechanics is probabilistic. But somehow this projector valued measures, so they have noise zero, and they give variances as good as it could come. Yeah, so you cannot avoid probability, but in a sense, the most sharp model is model based on projector valued measures. So in quantum measurement theory, you are allowed to work with POVMs. And in particular, what you can do, and I will show this in the next slide, you can measure simultaneously non-commuting observables. But variance will grow, and they grow exactly as this Azava noise operator prescribes. So Now there is a funny phenomenon related to this Azar-Van-Noy separator. So let's remind you Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So variance of f in state rho in the power 1/2 times variance g in the state rho in the power 1/2 is greater or equal than absolute value of expectation of commutator of g. Rho and coefficient is here 1/2 as well. So, and often I mean very naive conclusion from this is that we cannot simultaneously measure f and g. And the actually answer is the following, that actually we can, because for joint approximate measurements, so we can always arrange a POVM which measures both of them. But the problem is that variances will be higher, okay? And one can formulate an uncertainty principle here in the following way. So variance of W f rho in the power 1/2 times variance W g rho in the power 1/2 is greater or equal than 1 times expectation of commutator of g and rho. And so this is something which I call uncertainty jump. And this was observed long ago by physicists and examples. And in Ishikawa actually proved this rigorously. So it's like 30 years ago, this was proved rigorously, interestingly enough, unnoticed by experts in this field. And the jump of coefficients is based on noise inequality, namely that expectation of noise operator in space in state rho in power 1/2 times expectation of noise operator of g in state rho in power 1/2 is greater or equal than this 1/2 of the expectation of the commutator. So somehow this noise operator satisfies kind of uncertainty principle. And so then with all these preliminaries from quantum measurements, what we are doing, we are looking quantization as measurement. And that's a kind of, it's well known among physicists idea. It turns out to be very useful here. And so let's view quantization as measurement and let's just look at the corresponding noise operator. And so then noise operator, you can calculate it. It's th bar of f square minus th bar of f square. And this is nothing else in our story is h bar over 2 th bar of gradient square, skew gradient square length of f. So what we're doing, so we're taking Hamiltonian vector field and measuring its square with respect to this unsharpness metric, plus terms of higher order. And so then, if we remember that this Berezin-Toeplitz POVM can be written as dimension times d probability measure times some certain state, so it has state as a density, so then this term can be nicely expressed as expectation of this noise operator, which measures unsharpness in the coherent state. And so that's why we call this metric G to be unsharpness metric. It measures indeed certain unsharpness. And this decomposition is in very easy consequence of this noise inequality. Of this noise inequality, which actually is responsible for this uncertainty jump phenomenon. So in a sense, positivity of this unsharpness cocycle is exactly a consequence of and noise inequality. So it's a cousin of this unsharpness, uncertainty jump phenomenon in quantum measurement. Any questions at this point? Because I'm going to shift gears in the last few minutes. So anything you want to ask about measurement? Okay, so maybe I will move on. Okay, so then with all this language, you see, so let's look at the second statement of our main theorem. So volume of M with respect to unsharpness metric is greater or equal and volume of M omega and minimizers correspond to compatible metrics. So this is something which we call the least unsharpness principle. And this is exactly the question of the following kind. So what are optimal quantizations? So we say that we design certain way, yeah, so based on this unsharpness, how to define, how to choose optimal quantizations, and they correspond to compatible metrics. And I should say that the question about optimal quantizations appears in the literature, and one of the, actually there is a paper by Gerhenstaber of 2007, who I would say, of course, in a kind of different context and under different angle, but he addressed these questions and also kind of quantization which produces minimal increments of variances. So something like this can be extracted from his work. He did not work with Berezin-Toplitz context. Okay, so at this point I arrive to the question about classification of quantizations. Okay, and so that's I mean, I had several questions about this. So, first of all, what I should say that for star products, this question is solved to high extent. So here, admissible changes of variables look as follows. So F goes to F plus A1 H bar plus A2 H bar square plus so on, where AM of F is just differential operator. And locally in charts, it turns out that all star products are equivalent. So know that there is absolutely no positivity here. And globally, they are classified by formal power series with coefficients in second cohomology of N. So this started with the works of De Wilde and Lecomte in 93. And then there were works Fedosov, Delin, Nestzigen, Gutronsley. So somehow nowadays, this story is pretty well understood. In contrast to this, in case of Berezin-Toplitz quantization, the question is largely open, okay? And here is an attempt to make a definition. So fixed Hilbert spaces, HK, where K goes to infinity, H bar will be always 1/K. And here I give the definition. So I say that two quantizations, SH bar and TH bar, from C infinity of M to L of H bar are M equivalent. M is a natural number. If there exists unitaries UH bar, so that SH bar of F equals to UH bar times TH bar of F times UH bar star plus capital O of H bar in the power M. So what I want to take the whole bank in a sense, right? So I actually want to, if possible, to classify quantization up to equivalence. But the question is, what is the error? And error is human choice. I can take M equals to 1, M equals to 2, and so on. Okay? So is definition clear? Octav, I need like 3 more minutes.
Oh, yes, no problem. We have another half an hour.
Yeah, no, I will not do it, but I have...
For questions too, but I mean, you can certainly take a few minutes.
Yeah, so now it turns out that the answer pretty much depends on what's going on here on this end. Okay, so, and a kind of key observation is the following, is unsharpness unsharpness metric, it's certainly an invariant of two equivalents. And then, of course, we asked exactly the same question. Yeah, so does the unsharpness tensor determine the quantization or to what extent, as Daniel suggested? But we cannot answer this question. So the best we can do is the following. So let's consider the case study. It's two sphere, okay? And assume that HK is space of a reducible representation of SO2 of dimension K plus 1. So we are interested in SU2 equivariant quantization. So the best example is the following. You take simply a round metric on the sphere of areas 2 pi. So combine standard quantization with the standard diffusion. And so then you will get SU2 equivariant quantization. Okay. And obviously, the corresponding unsharpness metric will be just T times G, where T is some coefficient greater or equal than 1. Okay. So theorem, any two SU2 equivariant quantizations with the same unsharpness metric coincide up to capital O of H bar square. But equivariance is used to high extent here, and tools is representation theory, and actually we use representation theory and Legendre polynomials, and actually it's actual calculation, yeah. So some miraculously everything fits, I would say. Open problem, what happens in general, non-equivariant case, are there invariants of two equivalents beyond unsharpness metric? We don't know, and at the moment we do not have good ideas. But there is a work in progress, which, pieces of it are written, but it's not still kind of appropriate, so I will be careful here. There is room for mistakes. And you see this unsharpness metric is not an invariant for one equivalent. And actually, the question, the statement in progress is that all known quantization of S2 with dimension k, and k is important number because h bar is kind of 1 over k, are one equivalent. And the tool is the following. So we're developing theory of approximate representations for Lie algebra SU2. And in context of group, there is a fundamental paper by Kashdan, which generalized previous work by Grove, Karcher, and Drew, and which was in turn extended in a series of work by Lubotsky and his co-authors. So for groups, there are many kind of at least some tools. And interestingly enough, so these approximate representations of Lie algebra, so we need kind of new approaches in order to prove this theorem, and I hope that this will be written at some point. Okay, we'll see. And that's basically, that's it.
Okay, thank you very much, Leonid. Walk around a little bit on our different tables. Great. So so we have time for questions. And so I invite everyone who wants to speak to maybe unmute themselves or maybe give first a sign to unchat and ask questions. So let's see, there were of course questions during the talk already, but.
So Daniel has a question.
So I was just wondering, I mean, do the physicists have an opinion? Like, is there any physical reason why you should expect uniqueness or uniqueness given the unsharpness tensor, or?
Well, I think so from physical reason, but you should, my physical thoughts should be taken with a huge grain of salt, because I'm not an expert, actually. But I think that what you're really interested in as a physicist, so you have a quantum observable, which kind of is a quantization of classical observable. So that's what I believe physicists all the time do, So more or less, at least a lot of quantum mechanical Hamiltonians appear from kind of classical mechanical Hamiltonians with the help of certain quantization. But then, I am actually interested in its spectrum. Okay, and so because spectrum has obvious physical meaning, right? So I actually want to do measurements of this quantum observable, and I know that for Neumann observable, I mean, it takes values in its spectrum. I also probably want to know its eigenbasis. Okay, so if I have, moreover, now if I have several quantum observables, so then I want to know definitely, I mean, mutual position of their bases and their eigenvalues and so on, with certain degree of precision. So now it's totally clear that if you change quantization, so that's more or less what John asked at the very beginning. So how quantization depends on almost complex structure. So in the first level, in the first order of H bar, so at least for sphere, we believe that it does not depend. But on the other hand, in the second, it does depend. Yeah, and I believe that in the first order in H bar is not very kind of interesting viewpoint at spectrum, because what you more or less see, you probably see eigenvalues just going with step like 1/H bar. Yeah, so from maximum function to minimum function, you have a minimum of the function, you have very kind of trivial idea of the spectrum. And I believe that if you know unsharpness metric, you can say you can do better, have more information about the spectrum. Yeah, and so then this should be of certain interest to at least, okay, let's put it in the following way, it might be of certain interest to physicists. On the other hand, this idea, I mean, if already, I mean, we discuss physicists, yeah, so the idea, right, so Gerhenstaber, who looked for optimal quantization, is of course mathematician, but Clauder was a physicist. And Clauder was developing some idea of stochastic quantization, or quantization based on functional integral, so it's kind of mathematics far more complicated than I know. But his idea was that, you know, we simply cannot start doing quantization without knowing metric on the phase space. So we don't know even how to start. And what we said the following thing. So let's consider certain kind of system of axioms, and then metric arises by itself. So that's kind of a message of our work. Is it good, Dani? Yeah. Okay. So
this is a question from Felix. So Felix, you can ask.
Probably totally nice question, but so in this sharpness theorem, you minimize the volume by, so the volume is minimal if the J's are very good in the symplectic sense. What is the role, I mean, from a symplectic point of view, minimizing volume is extremely natural. So what is the role of
I can answer a slightly different question. So I can tell you what is the meaning of symplectic volume in quantization. What is volume of unsharpness metric is some measure of total unsharpness. That's I don't know. But symplectic volume has very nice meaning. And the meaning is as follows. So what is dimension of the space HH bar of quantum Hilbert space? Yeah, it's finite dimensional space. And the rule of the thumb is that we have one dimension for each quantum cell. So
with the cubes, okay, with the cubes and the
capacity, capacity like 2π h bar.
Yeah. Okay. Yes,
so that's exactly what we have here. Yeah, and so unsharpness is a kind of least unsharpness principle is a kind of attempt to bring I don't know some unclear dimension with respect to sharpness metric to the symplectic metric. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So a question from Yang Li.
So he can maybe if he wants to ask it, yeah. He can ask it.
or
this is just a kind of impression I got from your talk. So your kind of optimal quantizations tend to come from some kind of line bundles. So it seems to me there must be some kind of discrete structure to it. I mean, is it a kind of general phenomenon? Your other example comes from representation theory, which also has some kind of discreteness built into it.
No, I think, so let me clarify this point, because I think it's kind of important. So you see this optimal quantization, they come from compatible almost complex structures. So every compatible or almost complex structure gives optimal quantization. So that's what we proved. So now compatible almost complex structure, so they and there is no line bundle in the, so that's in a sense the whole point. So we started from axiomatic definition. So there is no complex line bundle in this story. There is no complex line bundle in this story. So this is just kind of some abstract system of axioms. So also in practice, so you see if you have a symplectic manifold, you look at all Keller metrics associated to it. So if you fix symplectic form, so you can deform almost complex structure, right? And then you get exactly the continuous family of, actually continuous and connected family of optimal metrics. But yes, so on the other hand, of course, if you in this our example, we can calculate everything, so like S2 and SU2 equivariant quantization, which is a kind of huge assumption, yeah. So then this discreteness becomes kind of indeed correct, since we have just one example. Does it answer the question?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Is a version for infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces infinite volume? Well, yes, that's question of Giovanni. Giovanni, maybe you will. Sorry,
I was wondering, in your approach, you have these finite dimensional Hilbert spaces, and it's difficult to kind of view them as a family, right? I mean, to compare them with each other. So I was wondering if there are some kind of L2 or infinite dimensional versions where you have H bar as a continuous parameter and you can ask these questions kind of more simply.
Yes, I think I know just one setting where I can answer your question. So there exists a version of quantization of Bargmann space.
Right.
And it's friends, so to say. So I don't know much about friends, so let's consider kind of. So what is Bargmann space? So you have just CN, and you have very nice quantization, which formally speaking lives in the Hilbert space. But then how I'm thinking about this quantization? So first of all, I stick to compactly supported functions. And this is first thing. And second, I can always, so after I fix the support, more or less, I can always project, compress my operators in the full Hilbert space to find a dimensional subspace of dimension, which is roughly calculated by the same rules. So if I take huge cube, so I just consider how many small cubes are inside, and I look at this dimension. And so then you get more or less the same Derezin-Toeplitz quantization, and then quite sure that everything we did will go there, okay? But of course, I mean, these compactly supported functions are a very special function. So for instance, operators which you get after quantization has trace property and so on. So there exists very delicate questions, I mean, which classes of symbols you can consider, yeah? So in order to get reasonable quantization, that's functional analysis, which I completely don't know. Does it answer the question?
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. So, Francis, do you want to ask the question loud? Francis?
Oh, yes.
Yes, so do you want to ask your question?
Oh, I was just wondering if you could clarify the answer to the question about the relationship between the symplectic volume and the quantization.
So let's consider there is the notion of quantum cell. So mathematical definition, standard mathematical definition of quantum cell is a cube with a standard cube in R to n, which up to some factor 2 pi, whose side is square root of h bar. So area of central section is h bar. Yeah, it should be actually 2 pi times h bar. So now we ask the following question. So it's a version of symplectic packing problem. How many disjoint cubes we can embed symplectically into symplectic manifold? So then the answer is, so if h bar is very small, so that's more or less volume divided by volume of such cube, which is again up to a constant h bar in the power n, where n is dimension, complex dimension of symplectic manifold. So claim that this is in the first order dimension of the Hilbert space. So you have one dimension for each cell. But then, does it answer the question?
Yeah, and then how does it depend on h bar? The dimension goes up and so you get more blocks. So that's why.
So it depends exactly in this way. So dimension of, in my story, dimension of h of Hilbert space, which with index h bar is of order 1 over h bar in the power n, or if you wish, volume of m divided by h bar in the power n. So when h bar is small, dimension grows. Mm-hmm. But as a kind of curious twist, I want to say that there was a very nice series of work of Maurice de Gosson, who decided to redefine the notion of quantum cell. And he defined it, roughly speaking, as a set which has capacity h bar. Yeah, and so then there is a whole story about it, but it so far kind of does not enter. At least, there is no, its link to quantization is way more sophisticated and way more clear. Mm.
Okay. Thanks.
You're welcome. Igor, please.
It's again a follow-up to the follow-up. So I was just wondering if there's a actual proof of the dimension formula that somehow uses notion of quantum cell. So maybe there's a way to relate it to some peak sections.
Yes, I actually believe that yes. I don't see Louis. Are you around? I don't see Louis.
Hello?
Yes. So in this way, Louis?
Yes.
So can you take this question?
Yes, but the question answers itself. Yes, the answer is yes. So there is a proof of the dimension formula using what we call coherent states, and what which is a peak section in that sense. Yes.
So who proved this?
The proof is, it's a proof of Kodaira embedding of Donaldson.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more a principle, it appears in the literature that way.
Uh-huh.
And then you can even understand the second order term, which is supposed to be the scalar curvature, as the size of this remaining size of this ball. So it's even more precise than that.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yep.
All right. Let's see. I think, let's see if there are any other questions, maybe. In any case, let's thank Leonid again. So Leonid, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.